comfort those in need. You lift us up on wings like eagles.
Let me welcome you this morning to the Thanksgiving service of the late Lyndon Dean Hendrickson-Sealey. As we've come together this morning, none of us could have projected ourselves into the future believing that we would be here this morning to say farewell to Lyndon. But that's how life is. We don't know what tomorrow holds. But the one thing that is sure, all our lives have been touched by Lyndon. And all of us are grieving his passing in one way or another. But be certain that this is not the end. Lyndon has left many, many memories with you, the legacy of his life and his love. I want to encourage you to allow this to remain in your hearts. As you remember his joviality and how open he was, how loving he was and caring, give thanks to God that you've been part of his life. And as we lay his remains to rest, I feel confident that Lyndon is at peace even now. A very emotional man, generous of heart. And we thank God, I thank God that I knew him. And so this morning as we've come together to celebrate, to give thanks, to remember, and to ask for strength for our own lives, let's just be still for a moment. After the death of a loved one, Jesus appeared on the scene and said to his sisters, he says, Martha, I am the resurrection and I'm the life. Anyone who believes in me, though they die, they will live again. And anyone who is alive and has faith in me will never die. It might seem a contradiction in terms, but what Jesus was actually saying that this physical death is only a doorway into another life. And that is the death one needs to fear, not this physical death. All of us have to pass through this physical death. And so we're going to take time to listen to a hymn that has been selected by the family. And as we listen to this hymn, let's just take time to give thanks to God for our loved one. Please be seated.
The Lord's my shepherd, I'll not want. He makes me lie in pastures green. He leads me by the still, still water. His goodness restores my soul. And I will trust in you alone. And I will trust in you alone. For your endless mercy follows me. Your goodness will lead me home. He guides my ways in righteousness, and he anoints my head with oil, and my cup it overflows with joy. I feast on his pure delights, and I will trust in you alone, and I will trust in you alone, for your endless mercy follows me, your goodness will lead me home. And though I walk the darkest path, I will not fear the evil one, for you are with me and your rod and staff are the comfort I need to know. And I will trust in you alone.
Let's draw near to God and ask Him for the strength we need in this moment. You've all been just touched by looking at those photographs and those memories, remembering the times you've shared with your loved one. And it is natural that you will be moved and want to shed tears. Don't hold back. It's only natural. When we love someone and they are removed from our circle, it hurts. And God has blessed us with the ability to release our emotions through tears. And so we come to the Almighty God in prayer. God, our Father, we come to you with our emotions overwhelmed by the removal of our loved one. No longer will we hear his voice or see his smile or feel his touch or his hug. But we want to say thank you for the years we have known him and shared in his life. Thank you for this rich legacy that he's left behind. Father, I'm asking for each one as they're going through their individual emotions, their sorrow, their pain. I ask, Father, that even now you will surround them with your love. You would comfort them and cause them to know that the everlasting God understands just where they are and is able to help them and to carry them through. I pray for Brenda, his wife, that, Lord, you would be near to her, that as she contemplates a future without her husband, that you will be near to her. I pray for all the brothers and the sisters and the nieces and the nephews, friends and neighbors, work colleagues who have known Lyndon. Lord, you know just where we are. We ask that you might help us in our time of sorrow. We pray that you will comfort us and strengthen us, and above all, help us to know that you are an ever-present help. And whenever we call upon you, you are there to help us. And so this morning, as we continue to reflect, to say our final farewell, we ask that you would just, Lord, grant us what we need, because you know, at every turn, for every stage of this proceeding, help us, we pray. But we ask all these things for your glory and your kingdom's sake. Amen. Say together the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And help us not to fall into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. David is going to come and read for us.
Psalm 27, a psalm of David. The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the strength of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? When the wicked came against me to eat up my flesh, my enemies and foes, they stumbled and fell. Though an army may encamp against me, my heart shall not fear. Though war may rise against me, in this I will be confident. One thing I have desired of the Lord, that will I seek, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to behold the beauty of the Lord and to inquire in his temple. For in the time of trouble, he shall not hide me in his pavilion. In the secret place of his tabernacle, he shall hide me. He shall set me high upon a rock. And now my head shall be lifted up above my enemies all around me. Therefore, I will offer sacrifices of joy in his tabernacle. I will sing, yes, I will sing praises to the Lord. Hear, O Lord, when I cry with my voice. Have mercy also upon me and answer me. When you said, seek my face, my heart said to you, your face, Lord, I will seek. Do not hide your face from me. Do not turn your servant away in anger. You have been my help. Do not leave me nor forsake me, O God, my salvation. When my father and my mother forsake me, then the Lord will take care of me. Teach me your way, O Lord, and lead me in a smooth path because of my enemies. Do not deliver me to the will of my adversaries, for false witnesses have risen against me. And such as breath and violence, I would have lost heart unless I had believed that I would see the goodness of the Lord in the end of the living. Wait on the Lord, be of good courage, and he shall strengthen your heart. Wait, I say, on the Lord. Here endeth the word.
We enter now to period to bring tributes, and I'm going to ask firstly to come, Dolores, to come and bring a tribute to her brother.
Our little brother, Lynn, our own big little brother, he's sure unique and like no other. Protective and caring, he would often withhold. Anything he thought would distress us would often go untold. During the last 26 years of Lynn's personal life, he faced hurdles from the beginning to the end. But he knew his brothers and sisters loved him dearly, and on us he could depend. In spite of all life threw at Lynn, he was still full of mischief and fun. He'd often hide around the corner, then pounce and watch you run. His spidery fingers would tickle shoulders and neck as he sneaks up behind you when you least expect. Sometimes suddenly a face would appear at the window, and looking in, two beady eyes and a wide toothy grin. That's Lynn. Lynn's arms always opened to give his special hugs. He'd wrap those arms around you and we'll see, feel safe and snug. Lynn, our gentle giant. Lynn, our loving cuddly bear. You are not gone. You're always with us because you're just right here. Sleep peacefully, my little brother.
I'm going to ask Ashworth to come now and bring family tribute.
Coffee, Jesus. I'll only read a little excerpt. And it was about a year ago that I went with Lyndon to Soul Society. We were both into soul music, and you know, at the beginning of the evening, we'd be there gently tapping our toes, nodding our head. And as the evening went on, those nods got bigger, the movements got bigger. And by the end of the evening, we would cut our own little circle and be strutting our stuff. It was a fantastic evening, and so much so that I would want to be part of the Soul Society, and that will be my ongoing legacy, to join that society and travel around the country, wherever they are, to be part of that. He was also a very, very warm, as you've heard, a very warm person. Whenever he came down to ours, whenever he met me, like you said, warm, open arms, big hug, shake of hands, and that was Lyndon all over. A warm, big, friendly person. My wife passed away 4.5 years ago, and that warm generosity of Lyndon was something that he was able to give me comfort in the journey of grief. I now say, thank you, Lyndon. It's been an honor to have known you.
Sometimes we think we can wax lyrical in moments, but the truth is, in moments like these, it's hard. Because you're wanting to cry, and the things you want to say seems to have just gone out the window because you are overwhelmed. It's okay. It's part of what grief is all about. I'm going to ask Rachel and Connie to come now and to share something for nieces and nephews.
Love and kisses to say goodbye to our companion, our loving uncle. Smiles flicker as we remember baritone chuckles that rolled through any room, coaxing the corners of listeners' lips to lift and join in. We can all remember being swept in for a smothering hug that was actually a trap. Impossible then to escape the mischief of tickles so incessant that lungs burnt from giggling.
Many a time on a Sunday, Auntie Dee and Shirley's, who had arrived so fatigued late from the hospital where you dedicated yourself to those in need. They were as lucky as us to share your time. You would arrive unannounced at any one of your brothers and sisters' houses, as you were never a visitor, but always right at home with your family. You always said you were just passing, but would chuckle to yourself a few hours later when you woke up for your after-dinner nap.
You showed us how we should adore our mums, dads, brothers, sisters, aunties, uncles and cousins, including family near or far, known or soon to be known. You taught us love, care, kindness and respect, all just by being you. We've learnt from you all there is to know about Action Man and flight simulators, and would never ever commit the ultimate sin of confusing Star Wars with Star Trek. You even trusted us with your keys to your brand new Lexus, despite the chance of scuffed alloys being more than likely. You were allowed to tease your siblings in a way that we would still never dare. You remembered the tiniest of details, even as years passed by, and gave references to those moments we all shared together. It's the little things that made you more than an uncle.
One more trip back home to sweet St. Kitts and Nevis. What a wish to sip some ting and gaze over gem-bright waters. Such is life, it seems, that we all must part, and yet knowing this does not dull the ache in our hearts. Now that you are gone to a better place, of course, we'll miss you, Uncle Lynn. Take care up there. We'll continue to remember you every day, and we cannot wait until one day we hear your jovial voice bellow, "Inside, greetings, family," and "Oh, my nieces," again.
Sometimes we ask the question, why do the young die, the good die young? I mean, whenever Lyndon was around, you knew his genuine love and care is tangible. His laugh so infectious, and just an open heart, an open man. Charlie's going to come and bring eulogy now.
It's quite a lot to say, but I'll try and condense it. I'm Shirley, the eldest of Lynn's siblings. Lyndon was born on the 4th of October, 1960, to Adora Hendrickson and Edward Dean Sealey. He was the youngest of eight children. We lived in Sparkbrook, Birmingham at the time. Mom and his dad worked, so from an early age, Dee and I, his sisters, brothers, aunt, Mrs. Clark, and Mom's best friend, Mrs. Corbin, helped with his upbringing. When his dad and Mom died, Dee and I, whom Lynn called Sis, and his brothers he called Big Brods, became his rock. He attended Montgomery Road Infant School. When the family moved to Stetchford, Audley Road Junior School, then Hodge Hill Secondary School, where he achieved his GCSEs. Lynn started his nursing career at Selly Oak Hospital, later to become part of the Queen Elizabeth Hospital complex. He worked in different wards, example, geriatric and rheumatology, and achieved special skills. He really enjoyed his nursing career, a testament to approximately 40 years in the profession, and he was due to return to service part-time in 2021 after retiring in 2020. His pleasant, jovial, caring, and professional attitude earned him the respect of patients and the medical staff. As a teenager, Lynn became interested in sprinting and hurdling. In those days, he was tall and thin, leaving his nieces, Dawn and Carol, nicknaming him Pin. He began training with Spark Hill Harriers and later joined Birchfield Harriers, competing at meetings. Whilst there, he met and married Brenda in August 1994. Despite several challenges, Lyndon remained caring and compassionate throughout. As a youngster, he owned a chopper bike and kept it for many years as a souvenir. He later took this mountain bike to St. Kitts on a holiday. Lynn had his first action man around the age of 6 years of age, and he continued to add others, forming a collection. Some people never grow up. He was the proud owner of several cameras, some capable of taking action pictures at Cosford Indoor Athletics or car racing, another one of his hobbies. He loved Nintendo games console, spending many hours flying jumbo jets, racing cars, tank warfare, all from his armchair. He also was a lifelong Star Wars and Star Trek fan, venturing out to the big screen at Star City, the big box, with a big box of popcorn and drink at his side, lounging back, enjoying the film, many times falling asleep. Lynn, trickster. Lynn took great pleasure in having classic cars with fancy gadgets, his latest being an executive Lexus hybrid. He always insisted in his spirit of sharing that his brothers took whichever car he had for a spin as name drivers. Wait for this. The Hendrickson boys always took pride in having a full plate of food, at the same time teasing each other of greediness. Lynn did the same and often went back for more, rubbing his tummy, stretching and groaning, then he would sleep it off. He claimed Mike, his brother, introduced him to Ling Tung Chinese takeaway when he was a teenager. He never looked back, visiting every Friday night and sampling the delights of McDonald's and KFC. We often told him that he had shares in them. His dress sense was immaculate. He was immaculately turned out in his bespoke three-piece suits and shoes from High and Mighty. Whew. He even took these suits on holiday. At an early age, Mom took Lynn on holiday to St. Kitts, Nevis, Barbados. He later visited Trinidad. Over many years, Lynn succeeded in becoming a snowbird and flying southwest to St. Kitts, along with Dee and I, and joined by in St. Kitts by our brother, Eustace, from the USA. St. Kitts and Nevis became his home from home. Lynn took pride in phoning his brothers in the UK, saying how hot he was whilst they were wrapped in the depths of winter. Then he would laugh, ha ha, and say, I bet you were here. I wish you were here. Oh, dear, dear, Lynn. He stayed overnight at the airport hotels on his way out and relaxed at times. And a couple of days he would return before going back to work in the UK. He would spend some time again at the airport. He accompanied Dee and I to City Road Baptist Church whenever possible. It was a pleasure to see him enjoying the singing and nodding in agreement during the sermon. Lynn did express to Mike, Dee and I a desire to be baptized, but he did not get around to arranging this. The Sunday before Christmas, he was due to attend church, but due to commitments at work, he was unable to do so. Lyndon's characteristics were warm, friendly, loving, generous, caring, big-hearted, a gentleman in every way. He always greeted his brothers and sisters, nieces and nephews with a loud, exuberant, and excited thrill. We give God thanks for giving Lynn to us as a family and for how he loved, lived, and shared God's true love to all. Rest in peace, brothers. We'll miss you. We love you, but you'll never be forgotten.
A very good morning to everybody. And a very good morning to you, Lynn. You see, you've got everybody here together, right? And we're laughing and we're clapping and we're smiling. But I want to sort of say a prayer for all of us here, for all the people listening in Buffalo, in St. Kitts, in England, for Winston, my other brother, with his family down in Southwold. I can't be here. For the cousins, there's one person in Hawaii, okay? That's our cousin Julia in Hawaii, different parts of the world. Okay, let's just come before God. God, our Father Almighty, we thank you. We thank you in this life. We thank you for Lynn. We thank you for the love that you showed, for the big hugs, for the smiles, for the funny things, for the gifts that you gave us. We thank you that he lived his life happily. He hardly ever mourned. He showed love, and he showed faith, and he showed fortitude. He faced all his battles, but never mourned about them. He tended to many people at the hospital. He consoled many. He held hands. He knew about life and death, but he knew his God that he worshipped as well. Father, we thank you that he shared our family. He was part of the family, for the wider family, the church family. We thank you as well for his workmates, his colleagues, and for Birchfield Harriers and all that went on. Thank you for his wife and the Lawcombs as well, and the extended family. Father, now he's run the race. He's had his 60 years, and he's with you. And for that, we give you thanks in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Before I go, let us give Lynn a big one of those. One, two, three. Lyndon. And again, Lyndon. And again, Lyndon.
My theme today is light in a dark place, and it's good to see that you can celebrate. Though your hearts are breaking, you can still celebrate. But before I speak to you this morning, we're going to listen to another hymn. For the beauty of the earth, let's just listen to this hymn now. moment I thought one of the, that what he had in his hand was this here, but it isn't. Life. Life is very, very challenging, that it is for us to live. And there are moments when it appears as though all the lights have gone out and we're left in a very dark place. David read to us the Psalm of David. It speaks about God's ability to help us at the most challenging time of our lives. And at the moment, for so many, it appears as though the light has gone out and all that there is darkness. But in such moments, we need some light just to shine in. And the fact that we can balance the sadness with some joy, that is good. Right now, your world, our world, two different perspectives. Your world as a family has been plunged into a place of sadness and darkness because your loved one is no longer there. No longer you're going to hear that voice or see that cheeky grin or those eyes peeping through the window or waiting to be tickled. That's not going to happen by Lyndon anymore. But there will be times when you will remember those quite keenly. Here we are in a world just about getting out of lockdown, but our world in general touched by this pandemic, and so many are in a very, very dark place. Our governments and our scientists are still working hard, and we thank God for the breakthrough that there has been and for the light that is dawning. Yesterday we stepped into a new place as far as this country is concerned, that people, two families, could meet together. And there will come a day, if you have faith in God, because I'm confident that Lyndon had faith in God, that one day you'll see your loved one again. But in the meantime, it's for you to allow that life that you have shared, the experiences you've had with him, to keep you in your time of sorrow. As we go through this time together, I want to remind you of the words of the psalmist. He says, "The Lord is my light." It's important for us to have our individual guiding light. Relationship with God is based upon the individual responding to the love of God. Just like when we build relationships with individuals, we fall in love and we get married. It's about individuality. And the psalmist was able to say, "The Lord is my light and my salvation." In other words, God guides me and provides an opportunity for me to go forward and to understand the complexity of the world and the society in which we live and I live. He said, "With the Lord is my light and my salvation." He says, "I have no need to be fearful." You have no need to be fearful this morning. Though your loved one has been removed from you and no longer will you be able to converse with him, you have no need to be fearful because you can have confidence that God, who loves him and loves you, will not only look after him, but will help you in this dark period of your life and take you into a new area of light. The psalmist then says, "The Lord is the stronghold of my life." What was he actually saying here? "The Lord is the stronghold of my life." What the psalmist was saying, that when I find myself in trouble, I go to God and he helps me. Who do you turn to in your sorrow and your pain? When you find yourself coming to the end of all your resources, you may be very strong in different areas or very resourceful, but there comes a time when we come to the end of that. Where do you go? He says, "He is the stronghold of my life, and therefore I am not afraid. And when difficulty comes, I go to him." The psalmist in Psalm 121 also says, "When I am surrounded by difficulties, I go to my God, and that's where I find help." Let us therefore remember what the psalmist says in verse 1. God is ready to light your path if you will allow him. God is ready to give you understanding in the areas where you're challenged. God is able to support you and to guide you. But the one thing he will never do is to take away your freedom of choice. It is up to you whether or not you ask him to become your life. A commentator on the word of God says, his name is John Gill, that in the Spanish Bible, the Targum, the King of Spain's Bible, explains it this way: the word of the Lord is my light. I live by the word of God. He guides me, and I live by that word. What do you live by? And when trouble comes, how does it hold up? You know, death and marriages have a way of bringing families into conflict. I want to say to you this morning, the conflict is as a result of the deep emotions that you're feeling and the deep relationships that you have. But remember this, God is there to help you through these times. And there are times when we are emotionally distressed, we respond in ways that we would not in otherwise. But God knows what you're going through, and he wants to help you and to support you and to establish you. David continued, and he said, though an army besiege me, though I'm in the midst of difficulty, he says, though war break out against me, when I am out of control and when I cannot control events, he says, even then I will have confidence in God. Things are out of your hands as far as your brother, your husband, your loved one, your uncle is concerned, your friend, your neighbor. He's no longer here. But God is here. David's greatest desire was to live in the presence of God, meaning to recognize that there was a God. In those days, you go to the temple to, as it were, access God. You don't have to go anywhere. Wherever you are, God is there. All you have to do is to call upon him. And David said, I desire to be in his presence so I can talk to him and ask him to help me in my time of difficulty. Some of you have turned to different family members to find comfort. David said, I turn to God, and there I find comfort. In a close relationship with God, that's where we find protection and safety in the midst of all kinds of troubles, and especially at this time. Now, remember, we would have our music festival on the lawn, and Lyndon would always be there, very joyous and joyful and helping with the flowers, you know, that Shelley and Dolores would be arranging. And he was a joy just to see. He just loved life. Whenever he comes on a Sunday, you know, I could see how moved he was by so many things. And yes, he expressed a desire, I want to take that step of baptism. But taking a step of baptism is only after one coming to a realization that God is real and you want a relationship with him. Some of us live behind the mask, but Lyndon was right there in front of your face. His heart was on his sleeve, as it were. And he wasn't afraid to cry. He was open. And he cared, and he showed how much he cared. I want to say to you, draw from that, and let your life be a light wherever you find yourself, that you will really reach out and care and live life to the full. And don't worry about what people will say. You know, it's good to allow that childish element of you to remain, because sometimes it becomes so serious. But Linda will always bring some joviality into the situation. The prophet Isaiah encourages us to seek the Lord, he says. Seek the Lord while he's near. We don't know what tomorrow holds. But one thing we do know, that God is always there, and he will never leave us, and he will never forsake us, and he will help us in every situation. When we're living in a close relationship with God, he helps us to navigate through the difficulties, the difficult path that challenges us. You know, when I'm sure family members would give evidence to the fact that Lyndon would come and have conversations with you about different things. And we all have conversations with different people about different things. Whenever we're challenged and we have confidence, we go along and we have a conversation. Every day of our lives, we can draw near to God and have a conversation with him. In verse 10 of the reading that David read to us, he says, though my father and mother forsake me, the Lord will receive me. The psalmist here was opening up a window for us. A relationship with your mother and your father is so close, and it's hard and difficult to consider or to contemplate that the father or mother would reject their own children. But we have seen that in our society even today. And David was saying that if we come to a place where those who are closest to us may reject us, God will never reject you. Rejection can take you to a very dark place. Psychological isolation and addiction oftentimes takes us to dark places. But God can take care of you and take care of your life if only you will allow him to. When we are moved or stirred by happenings and our emotions are inflamed and we want to respond and react in different ways, allow the light of God's word to stabilize your emotions so you may make the right response. You are hurting at the moment. God knows what you feel. You've missed your loved one, and to look ahead seems difficult without him. But I want to encourage you that God is there with you. He then goes on to say, "Teach me your way, O Lord, and lead me in a straight path." He recognized that because he was so challenged and all the things that were happening to him, and even those that he had confidence in were letting him down, he realized that he could behave in a way that wasn't the right way. So he said, "Lord, teach me and show me the right path. Show me how to behave in this situation." David did not allow his present situation to lose hope in God or in mankind. As I conclude this morning, he says in verse 13, "I remain confident of this." I remain confident of this, David said. "I will see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. No one will be able to replace Lyndon in your heart or in your relationships. But if you allow the love you have shared to remain alive within your hearts, then you can continue. And in fact, it can evolve into something much bigger, because so many of you are exhibiting aspects of Lyndon's character. And when you meet and you talk and you share, keep him alive in your relationships. We are going to get through this situation. Just as we are going to get through this pandemic, we're going to get through, when I say get through, we're going to get to a better place where we'll be able to live our lives and to say, we thank God that we have had the rich blessing of sharing in the life of Lyndon. The psalmist concluded by saying, now, as you're going through your difficulties, don't cast off. Don't cast off into the deep until you reach the other side. He says, wait upon the Lord. Though you may not want to go through these emotions, you have to go through them. Wait upon the Lord and ask him for strength to get through. He says, I remain confident of this one thing, he says. I remain confident that I will see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. What he was actually saying, that I will arrive back at a place where relationships will be cordial, I'll be able to laugh again, I'll be able to enjoy life. It might seem impossible to you, but it will come. It will come. Dwell on the blessing that was and still is yours as you remember your husband, your brother-in-law, your brother, your uncle, your friend. Rest upon that and know that God is near. Brenda, know that God will keep you in this difficult time. Know that God will carry you through. Shirley, Dolores, Michael, all of you. Know that God will carry you through. But also know this, there comes a time when we too will have to leave this world, and that we don't know when. And the best thing you can do is to prepare yourself by taking stock of where you are and realizing that life is very precious, and that individually we have responsibility for our own lives. Take responsibility. And the best advice I could give you as I conclude this morning, ask the Lord to guide you. And he will take you to places you never dreamed. You will embark upon an adventure that will be so amazing that you will wonder why you hadn't done it before. No longer will you feel alone having to get through or feeling self-sufficient. Because though you may feel self-sufficient and have all that you need, it is only when you taste the goodness of God you realize that what you had pale into insignificance in comparison to what God can give you. May God bless you. May God help us now and always. May he cause his light to shine upon us, giving us understanding of where we are and what we need to do. And may his grace be upon us evermore, that he does not, in a sense, treat us as we deserve, but as we need. Father, thank you for your goodness and your grace, for the life of your son, our brother, Lyndon. We thank you, Lord. We have spoken many words, and for some of us, they are just words, because we are hurting so much. But I pray that the experience that we have had individually with Lyndon in our lives will remain with us and will guide our own lives, both now and always. Amen. And so as we leave this time of saying our farewell, I want to encourage you to remember that God is near to you. But also that when you sense his presence and him speaking to you, it is then your responsibility to respond to what he says. May the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit rest, remain, and abide with us all, now and forevermore. Please remain in your place as we leave the church to make our journey. So,
burden is down, just remember. No need to cry.
join